Los Angeles is the second largest city in the United States, and it has an identity all of its own. The entertainment industry has brought parts of LA more wealth than it knows what to do with, and a population packed with household names. LA stretches 60 miles west from downtown, taking in Hollywood, Beverly Hills, and Westwood, reaching the coast at Santa Monica. Santa Monica was groomed as a beachside resort beginning in 1875 and enjoys cleaner air and cooler temperatures than the rest of LA. A stamping ground for writers, artists, and the unconventional, Santa Monica's pride and joy is a white sand beach wide enough to accommodate thousands of cyclists, joggers, sunbathers, and swimmers. The wooden Santa Monica Pier has been around almost as long as the town. Along the pier are snack stands and a 70-year-old carousel used alongside Paul Newman in the legendary motion picture The Sting. In the heart of downtown Los Angeles sits Chinatown and Little Tokyo. Pagoda-shaped buildings and an array of ornamental fire-breathing dragons were among the things LA's sizable Chinese community acquired when it relocated to present-day Chinatown in the 1920s to make way for Union Station. From the 1920s, LA's movie idols followed the lead of Douglas Fairbanks and Mary Pickford and colonized the hills and canyons above Hollywood. Soon, Beverly Hills had become a byword for glamour and mind-boggling wealth. The stately and secluded hillside homes of the rich and famous still fill Beverly Hills. But it's around the designer label stores on Rodeo Drive that you're most likely to spot the big names. At 2 Rodeo, the upscale outdoor mall, modeled after a stepped Italian piazza, attracts a constant stream of visitors. In 1999, marketing consultants recruited a multilingual former concierge to greet tourists under the clock at the corner of Rodeo Drive, to counter the perception that people in stores in Beverly Hills are haughty and snooty. LA without Hollywood is hard to imagine. For 8 decades, it has been the scene of the city's most public triumphs, disasters, scandals, and decadent extravagances. Hollywood's boundaries are hard to define, but you will know you've arrived when the Walk of Fame appears beneath your feet. Around 2,000 star-shaped brass plaques are embedded in the Hollywood Boulevard sidewalk, each embossed with the name of an entertainment industry notable who did not mind paying $3,500 for the privilege. Opened by Sid Grauman in 1927, Man's Chinese Theater draws 2 million visitors a year, not for the intricacies of its mock oriental architecture, but for the hand and footprints of screen idols who literally made their marks here when they were arriving for celebrity-packed movie premieres during the glory years. The Hollywood sign was erected in 1923 and illuminated with thousands of flashing light bulbs to advertise land sales in Beechwood Canyon in the Hollywood Hills. The 50-foot-high Hollywood sign became famous throughout the world as the movie-making area's most enduring marker. This is Los Angeles Union Station. It was built in 1939 in Spanish Mission style. It is large, spacious, and clean. And it is here where we are to meet the famous American Orient Express. The American Orient Express check-in opens 2 hours prior to boarding. It was here we were to get our first look at the gleaming 15 vintage carriages, painted in their signature blue and gold. Carriages that were assembled from museums and private collections throughout America. Each departure carries approximately 100 passengers, who will be attended to by highly trained professional staff and crew. According to the owner's brochure, their sole purpose is to not just meet, but surpass expectations of the quality service befitting the honored tradition of luxury rail travel. The American Orient Express is in the tradition of the legendary streamliner trains from America's past. Since the last streamliner trains made their final journeys in the 1960s, the nation's most scenic rail routes have been inaccessible to the discerning traveler. American Orient Express once again offers this wonderful cruise-on-rail holiday to travelers who desire to experience North America's natural wonders and cultural centers in comfort and style. The first part of our journey will take us north along the Pacific coast to Santa Barbara. Finally, the train gently pulls away from Union Station. We are passing through the built-up commercial areas of downtown LA, past the homes of Glendale, and past the studios of Burbank, heading towards the coast. The passengers gather in the bar for a welcome cocktail and to meet fellow passengers. The carriages are from the streamliner era and were constructed between 1948 and 1958. Each carriage has been totally reconstructed and restored at a cost of over $1 million per car. The latest heating, air conditioning, electrical and plumbing systems have been installed. Elegantly accented in mahogany, the interiors are designed to evoke a time when rail travel was luxurious, romantic and adventurous. Lavish attention to detail is apparent in the warm, rich tones of the woods, beautiful inlaid surfaces of marble, sparkling appointments of polished brass, painted ceilings, murals, and comfortable overstuffed lounge chairs. The club cars were originally built to seat up to 60 guests. The two club cars have been redesigned to accommodate a baby grand piano, full service bar, and comfortable couches, lounge chairs, and games tables. There is also standing room at the bar and around the piano. The Seattle and Rocky Mountain Club cars, as well as the New York observation car, can comfortably accommodate all passengers. Their plush armchairs and sofas are popular gathering places throughout the day and evening. Both club cars have painted murals and ceilings. The Rocky Mountain murals and ceiling were painted by artist Joel Dreyer. The midnight blue ceiling has the Milky Way depicted in pure gold leaf. The mountains meet the sky on both sides of the car. The Seattle ceiling of deep indigo and purple, with clouds on the horizon catching the first light of day, is sprinkled with stars of 23 karat gold. The New York observation car was dedicated in 1948 and served 20 years on the New York Central's famous 20th Century Limited. Plush seating and a circular bay window make this an elegant place to watch the rails and enjoy the magnificent scenery drift by through large windows. This is one of the most photographed passenger cars in North America. There are four types of sleeping cars: vintage Pullman, single sleepers, parlor suites, and presidential suites. Each sleeping car traces back to the days of Pullman and has been rebuilt to supply modern comforts while still maintaining its past elegance.
Our purpose or our mission is about enjoying rail travel, old world rail travel. This design of the cars are from the late 40s, early 50s. Our ambiance is from the late 20s and early 30s. So we try to keep the passage or the journey casual and comfortable with five-star service. And the luxury of time and the ability to enjoy that luxury is the mission of this journey. Generally, it's a romantic step back into time. There's no other way to explain it other than just stepping back. And you can go from Los Angeles to Seattle, as the trip you're on now, in 2 hours via air. It's a 7-day trip on our train. And it's really, truly about the luxury of time and relaxation. If you enjoy fine service, relaxed atmosphere, and great travel, as you know, looking out the windows, we feel we have the greatest movie screen in the world. It's just absolutely beautiful.
Early evening, and we slowly come to a halt. We will stable here for the night. The scenery is magnificent as the train sits 20 yards from the edge of a cliff overlooking the rolling surf of Capitan Beach. This evening, there is a special welcome dinner on board before our first overnight on the train. Dinner is in the Chicago and Zurich dining cars. An elaborate dinner is prepared each night on the train with menus designed to capture the individual flavor of each region we visit. The meals are prepared on board in two stainless steel kitchens by classically trained chefs. A selection of fine wines are served at dinner. Of course, no meal is complete without outstanding service, and the highly trained staff provide the highest level of personal service. Day 2 takes us further north along the coast to San Luis Obispo, where we will later stable at Paso Robles, halfway between Oakland and Los Angeles. As the train continues up the coastline, some of the passengers sit to watch the unfolding scenery roll by. The train is traveling to Paso Robles, where we will travel by coach to Hearst Castle. As a man-made introduction to the region, it is hard to beat Hearst Castle, a monument to incredible wealth and incredible architectural aspirations. The castle sits dreamily on a mountain slope above the village of San Simeon, just beyond Big Sur. William Randolph Hearst, the legendary newspaper magnate, based his enchanted hill on a Mediterranean village. The magnificent main house, Casa Grande, and the three guest houses are of Mediterranean revival style, with the imposing towers of Casa Grande being inspired by a Spanish cathedral. The blending of the architectural style with the surrounding land and the Hearst's superb European and Mediterranean art collections was so seamless that world-renowned architectural historian Lord John Julius Norwich was moved to say that Hearst Castle is a palace in every sense of the word. Spectacular formal gardens ornament the grounds of the castle. Inspiration was found in the great Italian and Spanish gardens of Europe. Magnificent panoramic views of mountains, coastline, and ocean enhance the elaborate features and formal landscaping of the gardens. The indoor Venetian pool was used by Hearst's guests in the evenings. Every surface of the pool, walls and ceilings, are a mosaic of hammered gold and delicate Venetian glass tiles. In contrast is the outdoor pool, where the Greek temple facade by the Neptune pool was created from various pieces of Hearst's vast art collection. After a full afternoon looking around Hearst's weekend ranch retreat, we returned to the train, which was due to depart in the early hours of the next morning. Day 3. We travel through the morning from San Luis Obispo to our next destination, the colorful and sophisticated San Francisco. On arrival at San Francisco's Oakland station, we check into the Huntington Hotel, situated on the well-known and expensive Nob Hill, before our first excursion to Muir Woods National Monument, 12 miles north of the Golden Gate Bridge. Up until the 1800s, many Northern California coastal valleys were covered with vast redwood trees, similar to those now found in Muir Woods. The forest along Redwood Creek was spared from logging because it was hard to get to, and now there are 6 miles of trails which lead through a dark, cool grove of redwoods. We return to the hotel, and the afternoon is ours to spend at our leisure exploring the exciting sights of San Francisco. San Francisco consistently tops the polls as America's favorite city. Streets soar up and plunge down steep hills, framing dramatic views and concealing quiet neighborhoods. It is a beautiful city, set on a small hilly peninsula, and is an easy place to fall in love with. Since Gold Rush times, settlers from far corners of the globe have arrived here. Nob Hill, Russian Hill, and Telegraph Hill are prime residential areas, yet they nestle close to the bustling streets and alleyways of Chinatown and the Italian-flavored North Beach. Chinatown is squeezed into a few chaotic blocks between the Financial District and North Beach. It is a riot of exotic sights and smells. Dragon-tailed entwined streetlights and pagoda-style buildings overlook a ceaseless procession around the food stalls on Stockton Street. Russian Hill has some of the city's prime real estate, as well as the famous 1,000 block of Lombard Street, which wiggles down the hillside and wins accolades as the world's crookedest street. The city is famous for its trolley cars, and it was certainly a safer way of negotiating the steep streets rather than a horse-drawn wagon. A must for tourists is the famous Golden Gate Bridge. Taking its name from the bay it crosses rather than its colour, the Golden Gate Bridge is a remarkable artistic as well as an engineering feat. Its construction defies the currents and depth of the bay, and the simplistic designs look entirely at home in a stunning natural landscape. Almost 2 miles long, with towers as high as a 48-story building, it is still among the world's largest suspension bridges and can be crossed by car or on foot. Fisherman's Wharf is the one place in San Francisco where tourists outnumber locals. Once the base of a large fishing fleet until the 1940s, today the wharf is almost entirely devoted to the tourist. If there is a single focus for the Fisherman's Wharf tourist catch, it's undoubtedly Pier 39. A remodeled working pier with restaurants, souvenir shops, and troops of photogenic sea lions lounging on pontoons in the harbour. Along with its famous landmarks such as Coit Tower and the Transamerica Tower, it would be easy to spend more time in this colourful city. But perhaps not so much as those spending the time in Alcatraz. On day 4, we travel by coach from San Francisco to Napa Valley before rejoining the train later in the day. Robert Mondavi's international wine promotions in the 1960s popularized the 25-mile-long Napa Valley, where about 250 wineries operate today. Some of the nation's biggest and most prestigious wine producers are found in the Napa Valley. At our first stop, the group splits in two for a visit to two local wineries for tours and wine tastings. Our first visit takes us to Mum's Napa Valley Winery, where Mum Cuvée Napa was conceived with the intention of creating the finest sparkling wines in the United States, using the traditional method champenoise. After a close look at the various grapes used, we are taken on a brief tour showing the process used to produce the champagne before moving on to our next stop, the renowned Napa Valley Wine Train, where the groups meet to enjoy lunch. At Mum's Napa Valley Winery and Vineyard, we are able to sample the results of Divo's efforts. From the moment we enter the wine train, we begin a three-part adventure. A return to the era of elegant rail travel, a deliciously crafted culinary and wine experience, and a relaxing journey through the heart of Napa Valley's picturesque vineyards. The wine train carries more than 300 people daily on a 36-mile trip up the middle of the valley, bordered by 27 wineries in the throes of harvest. Throughout much of its history, the Napa Valley Railroad was powered by steam locomotives, with the conversion to diesel engines coming relatively late in 1938. Today, the Napa Valley Wine Train is drawn by 1950s vintage FPA-4 Alco diesel locomotives, painted in the railroad's colors of champagne, burgundy, and grape leaf green. With the threat of the line being abandoned and discontinued, the Napa Valley Wine Train purchased the track in 1987 and immediately repaired the track, ready for a limited passenger service to begin in 1989. When passengers board the Napa Valley wine train for the serene journey through California's famed wine country, they step back into an era when rail travel was tantamount to the finest serviced and the most elegant surroundings. From the mahogany paneling and brass accents to the etched glass partitions and wall carpeting, passengers are enveloped in elegance that reflects the tradition of the finest early 20th century European railroads, such as the Venice-Simplon Orient Express and the Andalusian Express. Each of the Napa Valley wine train's four parlor cars, dining cars, and kitchen car were found through an extensive North American search for turn-of-the-century era rolling stock. The cars, which were all in disrepair, were all renovated and refurbished from the wheels up to create the elegance and sophistication of the 1920s and 1930s. The parlor and dining car interiors are richly refurbished in elegant period style with crystal chandeliers, brass trim, mahogany paneling, woolen carpet and rich upholstery. The two dining cars seat 60 guests each for formal dining in relaxed elegance. The kitchen car carries a fully equipped stainless steel kitchen in which all wine train meals are prepared. Guests may watch the chef and his crew at work from the car's mahogany-lined passageway. The lunch trains also have a deli car, where an a la carte menu is available for those who do not desire a complete gourmet meal. As the train meanders along at 4 miles per hour, there is plenty of opportunity to view the wineries and vines on softly sloping hills. After visiting another winery, the locomotive is turned around and we return to Napa Valley Station. We rejoin the American Orient Express, where it will remain stabled for the night in the Napa Valley. With fields either side of the train and a pond playing home to geese and ducks, the train appeared to be camped in a field, and there was an opportunity for passengers to leave the train and take a country walk in the evening. Day 5 will take us from Napa Valley to Sacramento, through the Feather River Canyon en route to Portland, Oregon. The journey to Sacramento takes 2.5 hours. On our arrival in Sacramento, we set out to explore California's capital. Our first stop is a visit to the California State Railroad Museum, a monument to the past, present, and future of the railroad. The museum preserves the history of the railroad, which aided in the development of California. The museum boasts a dazzling collection of old locomotives and imaginative displays, clarifying the crucial role of the railways in California's development. Today, Sacramento may seem an odd choice for a state capital, but in 1854, it was the gateway to the gold mines, and men, machinery, and money were streaming through. Returning to the train, we then embark on the country's most scenic rail journey through Feather River Canyon. It was an afternoon to sit and enjoy the journey as the train wound its way gently up and around through the mountains where the railroad ascends or descends the western slope of the Sierra Nevada Divide. After passing through Kedi, the train begins its descent from the mountains. This evening, we enjoy dinner and overnight on board as we continue traveling north to our next destination.
Feel as if you didn't have enough time and you'd like to come back again. And that's always a component of good travel, isn't it? That you'd like to be able to have a little bit more time.
To me, traveling the rails, just kind of sharing
the scenery.
Other,
is
the scenery.
It's just, yeah. It's wonderful to look out of the train and just see the country, a way that you could never, ever see the country any other way. You travel in a car, someone has to drive, someone can't look out and see the rest of the scenery. So it's amazing to be here, to not have to drive, to not have to know directions, to get to all these wonderful places, to have it planned for you. We just want to stay longer and do more.
And when I get off on Tuesday morning, I'm going to feel like Cinderella. You know, it's just, it's like a dream to be able to do this kind of thing. The scenery, the excursions we took, the quality of the food and the service. Life just isn't like this anymore. It's a way of life that's gone forever.
Day 6 and the penultimate day of our journey takes us further north and into Portland, Oregon. As we'll be stabling overnight in Portland, the engineers briefly have to separate the train in two, as we are blocking the entrance to the station for the incoming trains. The trains are separated, power and water are reconnected, and the train will remain in two halves until the evening, when the track is no longer needed until the next day. Mid-morning, and we are in the Timberline Lodge in Mount Hood, the highest peak in Oregon. Nestled at the 6,000-foot level on Mount Hood, this lodge is a National Historic Landmark built in 1937 of mammoth timbers and native stone, and stands today as a tribute to the rugged spirit of the Pacific Northwest. We take time to explore the historic lodge, including the unique stone fireplace, where upon the building of the resort, Native American symbols were sandblasted into its stones. During the afternoon, we traveled along the Columbia River to see Multnomah Falls, the fifth highest waterfall in the country. The falls plummet 542 feet down a mossy rock face, collect in a pool, and then tumble another 70 feet to the ground from its origination, Larch Mountain. Folklore has it that when a sickness threatened the Multnomah tribe, the chief's daughter threw herself over the falls to appease the Great Spirit. The quaint Benson Bridge spans the rocks above the lower waterfall. Multnomah Falls are a timeless and beautiful natural wonder, surrounded by trails and views of the Cascade Mountains and Columbia River Gorge. We arrive back at the train for our last night on board and special farewell reception dinner.
My name is Anthony Hubbard. I'm the executive chef, and I just wanted to thank you. I just wanted to take a moment to personally thank all of you for joining us here on the American Orient Express. It's been a wonderful week. A few of you have been with us for more than a week, and it's always a pleasure to have you folks aboard. For the rest of you, it's been a wonderful trip, and it's truly been our pleasure to serve you. So for myself, to you all.
The evening is lively, with the resident pianist playing into the early hours.
I know.
day 7 and the final day of our journey. As the passengers rise and make their way to breakfast, the train is en route to the Emerald City, Seattle, where we are due to arrive at 10 a.m. As the train rolls past Puget Sound to Seattle, the passengers are preparing to disembark. Curved around the shore of Elliott Bay, with Lake Washington behind and the snowy peak of Mount Rainier hovering faintly in the distance, Seattle is beautifully set. The early settlement was named Seattle in honor of a friendly native, Chief Seelph. Both moniker and settlement survived the skirmishes and ambushes of the Puget Sound War of 1855 to 1856. A conflict that resulted in local natives being consigned to reservations. Downtown Seattle has two enclaves of color and character. Pike Place Market, a busy, crowded morass of stalls piled high with lobsters, crabs, salmon, vegetables and fruit. Farmers first brought their produce here in 1907, lowering food prices by selling straight from the barrow. Pioneer Square is Seattle's oldest section. The square's old red brick, black wrought iron, and heavy stonework bear the unmistakable hallmark of a well-tended historic district, with bookshops and galleries adding a veneer of sophistication. Downtown, you can ride the monorail north to the Seattle Center, to the futuristic flying saucer-top town of the Space Needle. King Street Station. The final farewells are said, and everyone is sorry that the glorious journey up the Pacific coast is over. Friends have been made, and there is a bond between passengers that they have experienced one of the finest rail journeys in the world. As the crew of the American Orient Express assist the passengers to disembark, everyone begins to plan their time in Seattle before their flights home. There is chaos as luggage is collected from the front of the station and taxis are ordered. The crew begin to prepare the train for its next guests, and there is much work to be done. Along with many of the passengers, we gather our luggage and make our way to our hotel, keen to explore the sights of this vibrant city. As the crew reboard the train, we say farewell to one of the most luxurious trains in the world, the American Orient Express.